أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم لا سيما بقية الله روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمه الفداء أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وإذا سألك عبادي عني فإني قريب أجيب دعوة الداعي إذا دعان فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ صدق الله العلي العظيم اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد Respected scholars, brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته Last night we touched about the significance of fasting, layers of fasting, purposes of fasting, and to improve our intentions and attentions to fasting. In Farsi, we call fasting roze. What do you call it? Do you say roze as well? You know why it is called roze? Perhaps in Urdu also they call it roze, I suppose. Because it's a day activity. Roze, it means day. Roze is an action related to the day. So because fasting is observed during the daytime, in Farsi and Urdu and similar languages, it is referred to as roze. This is part of the story of Ramadan, or half of the story of Ramadan. Another part of the story of Ramadan that is hidden, is more secretive, and less spoken about, and perhaps less paid attention to as a result, is what inshallah from tonight I will be introducing or bringing more to our conscious. And that is about the night activities in the month of Ramadan. Remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ أَلَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ The month of Ramadan. A month consists of days and nights. So days of the month of Ramadan, yes, we observe inshallah fasting. What about the nights of Ramadan? Are we free? There is nothing to do? No obligation? No activity? There are a lot to do, in fact. And that is something, inshallah, from tonight as we are approaching the first major occasions ahead of us are the nights of Qad, the Shahadat of Imam Ali alayhi salam. From tonight, inshallah, we'll get prepared for those great occasions. The ayah that I started my talk with, inshallah, one more time, I read it. If I may ask you to repeat after me, it's okay. I think it's good to bless your mouth, not that just listen the ayah of the Quran. أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ This ayah is along the ayat in Surah Al-Baqarah talking about or in the bunch of the ayat about the month of Ramadan. Few ayat before that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about the obligation of fasting. كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ Some rules of fasting is mentioned and then comes to this ayah as a reference if you wanted to find it. I think ayah 185, 86 something in Surah Al-Baqarah. The tone of this ayah is definitely unique in the entire Quran. So there are some rhetorics, some kind of approach and a grammar involved in this ayah that definitely we don't find it anywhere else in the Quran. The ayah speaks to us so compassionately, so intimately, so informal and friendly that it is beyond imagination how much the Almighty God shows that He is eager in earnest in communication with us. God is mushtaq. God is so enthusiastic to communicate with us. Allahu Akbar. Although we are the needy. Ayyuhan nas, antumul fuqara'u ila Allah. You are absolutely needy. Wallahu huwal ghaniyyul hamid. God is needless. So it's supposed to be that the needy should be eager to go to a needless. Amazingly, God shows so much interest how eager I am to communicate with you. Therefore, passes this message to the Prophet to pass it to us. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي. First, let me underline some of the key words or pronouns in the ayah. 7 times Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, my servant, my slave, my. It's just like sometimes you call your son and said, Ahmad, come. Or you say, my dear son, come. You see, the second approach, there is more compassion in it. There's more intimacy. Your son feels more like, more loved by dad, huh? Rather than just calling his name, the way that he... In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ, when my slave asks you, سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي, they ask you about me. This, my point is about this pronoun of me. That 7 times is repeated in this ayah. إِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي. This is the third time. I am قَرِيب. One of the divine names, therefore, according to this ayah, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-qarib, near. We read elsewhere in the Quran that God is nearer to us than the jugular vein. God is nearer to us than even when a thought crosses my mind. Before I'm conscious about it, God knows about it, of course. Alright? Example that I give, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. Forgive me for the example so that we can grasp the point. It's just like that the waves are in the air already. Once I turn on my mobile, I can, you know, I can receive a call, isn't it? So the connection from the base, from the telecommunication is on. My receiver is switched off. This ayah is talking to us how to turn on our receiver. God says, I'm already sitting beside you, figuratively. أَنَا جَلِيسُ مَنْ ذَكَرَنِي. You just need to notice me around you. I'm so near and close to you. I'm not far from you. You just need to be conscious of my presence. That's all about it. إِنِّي قَرِيب أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ. Anyone who calls me, I answer them. It's not that God is not busy now. Humans, you want to see someone, they don't have time for you now. Make an appointment, come later on. Ujibu, yani immediately. As soon as you say, Ya Allah, labbaik abdi, the answer comes to you. Ujibu da'wat ad-da'a, idha da'an. Idha da'an, it means any time. Not only the nights of Qadr. Not only when you are in the mosque, wherever, elsewhere in the Quran says that you are lying down in bed, talk to God, God answers you. You want to park your car, say, God, find me a parking spot, God answers you. Some people, they think that, isn't it bad that I ask God for, just example came to my mind, for parking spot? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling Prophet Moses, even the salt of your food, ask me, I will grant you. Get to the habit of such a good habit. Inshallah, if I get a chance to talk about that, I'll mention this. What a good habit that anything you want to do. بِحَوْلِ اللَّهِ وَقُوَّتِهِ أَقُومْ وَأَقْعُدْ. You want to stand up? Ya Allah. Sit down? Ya Allah. With the help of God, I stand up. With the help of God, I sit down. With the help of God, I love. Anything and everything I want to do, always Pambar says that I was sitting with Amirul Mumineen alayhi salam. Every time that he was putting a morsel of food in his mouth, he was saying some zikr. I went close and I saw that Imam with every morsel of the food, Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, Bismillah. I said, Ya Amir al-Mumineen, isn't it that when we want to start the food, we say Bismillah? The Imam says, yes, every morsel of the food is a start of the of eating. Impossible, I cannot chew a food without remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's just enough that something goes wrong and I lose my life. So ujibu da'wat ad-da'i idha da'an, any time that they call upon me, I'm there for them. Allahu Akbar. Astaghfirullah, forgive me God for this example. How can I say God is available 24/7? He says, how often are you available for me? Now you tell me, who is the servant, who is the master here? I am your master. I'm available for you 24/7. You are supposed to be my slave. How slack are you? In dua Abu Hamzat al-Thumali, we learn from Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam that every time, Ya Allah, you invited me over. أَقْبَلَ إِلَيْكُمْ شَهْرُ اللَّهِ, the month of Ramadan came to us. We didn't go to it. An invitation came to me. I came here. I'm in your house. And then again, I became like bored, losing my attention. Imam Zain al-Abidin says that, Ya Allah, why is it that I'm so deprived? How more can you be generous to me? And how more can I be stingy? إِذَا دَعَانْ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي, if that's the case, if you have such a generous, always available master, lord, cherisher, provider, فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي, where else are you going? Who else is there for you always available to grant whatever you want? وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي, it's about the time, believe in me, believe in me. The nights of Ramadan, this ayah, as I told you, is along the ayah related to the months of Ramadan, specifically talking about the activities during the nights of the months of Ramadan. The nights of the months of Ramadan, brothers and sisters, is as holy as its days. Alright? Days of the months of Ramadan, we are fasting. Nights of the months of Ramadan, try, and more than half already has passed. Inshallah, I will mention this, repeat this again. The last 10 nights of the month of Ramadan, from the night of 20-21st, it was a prophetic tradition that they were just folding all the mattresses at home. Even children were not sleeping night time anymore in the nights of the month, the last 10 nights of the month of Ramadan. That gets to the heart of it. Have activities at night, that I tell you what kind of activities. Although we have supplications for the days of the month of Ramadan, but subhanAllah, how blessed we are. Tomorrow night I have to talk about particular supplications in the month of Ramadan. Tonight is just an introduction. Inshallah, tomorrow night you will be proud of yourself being among the lovers and the followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. When I share with you the living miracles of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, that you don't need to have any theological debates with anyone. The miracles of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam are available. You think that your Imam produces better than this? Here you go. So let us see. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that nights of your life are so significant. In any career you are, even if you want to be successful in your school, alright, as in any field, and I'm talking about so-called secular studying, just by day studying and day activity, you will not get there. You need to sacrifice some nights of your life as well. I'm sure many of us have experienced that, especially in this corporate world today. Okay? For a spirituality also, definitely this is the case. Definitely this is the case. Hafez, one of the very famous Iranian poet and Sufis, he says, آه شب و دعای صبح کلید گنج مقصود است. I translate it. He said, the sighing early in the morning, the supplication at night, this is a secret key to your salvation. And that's why supplication is the secret key to a treasury, to a hidden treasury, for those who want it. Imam Hassan Askari alayhi salam says that inna al-wusul ila Allah safarun, nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a journey, often is a lifetime journey. La yudrak illa bimtata'il layl, impossible to get near to God unless you spend some nights of your life repeatedly, constantly and continuously for dedication to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, night time. And I'll now give you some proofs from the Quran so that inshallah we are left with no doubt. As I told you, we are getting prepared for Laylatul Qadr. First of all, why night? Day of Qadr? Laylatul Qadr. The significance is in the night. The treasury is hidden. Night is secret. Inna nashi'ata al-layla hiya ashaddu wat'an wa aqwa muqila. The spirituality that you can gain and night time is stronger than daytime. Daytime inna laka fi an-nahari sabhan tawila. Naturally, all of us daytime we have some day activities, family, business, people, distractions are around, isn't it? It is night time that وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَغْشَاهَا, when the blanket is put on the planet Earth and darkness comes, intimacy begins. It is the night time when all the doors are closed that the divine doors will open. It is the night time that وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى, it is the night time that the calmness, life will be quiet, gives you a chance to yourself. Daytime we have to go to work, it's inevitable. Seven times because of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran takes an oath by night. Wallayl, wallayl, wallayl. Already some of its ayat I mentioned. Wallayl idha yaghshaha, wallayl idha. This waf here is for qasam, by Allah, by night. So night has a significance. When the Prophet of Islam sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam wants to go to his spiritual journey, mi'raj, ascension, subhanalladhi asra bi'abdihi laylan min al-masjid al-haram ila al-masjid al-aqsa laylan. Question, why God didn't take his messenger daytime? Why nighttime? I'm innocent. صلوا على محمد وعلى محمد محمد. Why is it that one of them is disconnected, maybe with the batteries? Okay, all right, do you want to turn it off?
Yes, this way. Okay, one is in
that's something. Why is it that the Almighty God is taking his Prophet night time to that ascension and mi'raj? In Surah Al-A'raf also, we read similarly about Prophet Musa alayhi salam. وَوَاعَدْنَا مُوسَى ثَلَاثِينَ لَيْلَةً وَأَتْمَمْنَاهَا بِعَشْرٍ. We have made an appointment with Moses 30 nights, not 30 days. And we completed it to 10 more to make it 40, again nights. You follow the track of this ayat, subhanallah, you see there must be a treasury at night. Almost half of our life is nighttime. How most of it, as at best, we spend it for sleeping. That means such a great treasury we are missing every night of our life. Laylatul Qadr, I will mention that inshallah to you. Laylatul Qadr, one of the meanings of it is Qadrul Layla, so that you become conscious of the value of the nights of your life, so that you value the nights of your life. Don't spend it just for socialization. Don't spend it for changing channels. Don't spend it for browsing on the net, past time, wasting time. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Ahsan. So one of the major activities during the month of Ramadan related to the nights of the month of Ramadan, and in as much as we have planned for the days for fasting, we got to have plans for the nights, not for feasting. Some people, they think nighttime is only to just stuff themselves. From Maghrib to Sahari, stuff yourself because you've got a marathon during the daytime. No, for intimacy with Allah, for supplication with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with dua and privacy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The significance of supplication is that supplication makes the relation between us and God from a monologue and one-way relation to a bilateral, two-way relation. As I told you, the relation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to us is always on. The connection from Him is always on. It's the connection from us that has to be turned on. By supplication, I will turn on that connection as well. I will be in the magnetic field of communication with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The way to get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at least are two ways. This is what we learn in philosophy. One is through the effect to find the cause. You see that, for example, the lights are on here. You see that there must be a switchboard somewhere. Okay? You see someone's child, there must be a parent's effect. Leads you to the cause. Okay? We see the trees, we see the galaxy, there must be a designer behind it. The proof of design. Better than this, more accurate than this, is that from the cause you find the effect. From the cause, yani through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you find the creation of God. This is the style that Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam in their supplications have been introducing to us. Beka araftuk وَأَنْتَ دَلَلْتَنِي عَلَيْكَ وَلَوْلَا أَنْتَ مَا أَدْرَ مَا أَنْتَ. Because of with you I came to know you. It is through you that I learned about your creation. Okay? If I get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a normal, direct way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you are a good slave of mine. And I voluntarily go and sit and communicate with God in supplications. Not that necessarily my business is going down, not that necessarily my family is breaking, not that someone or myself is diagnosed with a terminated illness. Things apparently are normal, yet I'm praying to God. I don't miss my prayers, supplications and everything, and I enjoy intimacy with God because I enjoy intimacy with God. But if I'm not that kind of person, remember I mentioned before that God loves us so much, sometimes deliberately He puts me down so that I struggle to come up. And He makes it that I go, if I'm ignorant, I come to you for help, don't get anywhere. Go to someone else, don't get anywhere. Go around the world, nobody's there to help me. I see that everywhere I go, it's a no way, no way, no through road, no through road. All the doors are locked behind me. I become muzdar, absolutely desperate. I don't know where else to go. Who else to seek help for? Okay? أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ. We say this, but unless you are really desperate. I don't know how you in your life you have experienced that. That you were sure that it's it. Finish. I'm really finished. That's the end of it. This is the muztar, the desperate person. In that very moment when we approach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we find Him so near and miracles happen. God says sometimes, so it's my wisdom and mercy, hidden mercy for you. I put you through some hardship in your life because I love you. I know that you man, unless you go through hardship, you don't become God conscious. Question. Usually people are more God conscious in their wedding or funeral. Simple. Do you hear more of the Quran recitation and Islamic talks in weddings or funerals? In funeral because it's a sad occasion. Naturally, normally we humans in sad occasions we become more God conscious. So the wisdom behind those sad occasions, poverty, illness, and the rest, read between the lines. God is sending invitations for you to go to Him. One of the Iranian Sufi and poet, Rahmatullah alayha, a female, she puts it in a very nice poetry way. I have to just explain it naturally to you. She says, once upon a time, a poor man with a big family, some of his children also being sick, jobless on the top of it as well, he left home in the morning another day seeking for a loaf of bread to get something for his family. Coming back, unfortunately, as usual again in the evening, empty-handed. No penny was made, and his wife is complaining, children are complaining, he is starving himself. Desperately, on the way back home, he popped into a miller, the mill where they are grinding the grains, making flour for bread. And says, brother, wallah, the whole day I've been looking for a job, and I'm penniless, I don't have anything, my family are starving and sick. Please, for God's sake, if you can give me something. Any door today I knocked, none of them opened, and nobody cared to help me. The miller said, all right, bring your shirt. Because you are getting it for free, I can't afford to even put in a plastic bag for you. Bring your shirt and pour some like wheat on his shirt. The man just ties a knot in his shirt and starts getting out of the mill. On the way in the darkness, as he is walking, it's poetry way, I'm just translating it briefly. He started talking to God, Ya Rab, how many knots in my life, sickness of children, unemployed, poverty, and all these things. Please undo some of the ties, some of the knots in my life. It's not a big deal. You can do miracle. As he was conversing with God and walking, all of a sudden he slipped over a piece of rock, and guess what? All the grains of wheat fell on the floor, spread around in the darkness of the night. Oh my God, the only provision for my family, look what happened. He got so upset, turned around, looks at God, astaghfirullah, I'm saying this here on the minbar, started it. What kind of God are you? Look at him. What a clumsy God. After all, you are undoing some ties and some knots in my life. I didn't tell you to undo this one, man. You are undoing the tie of my shirt, after all. He was so upset with God. I'm not kidding. It's serious. It happens to us sometimes. When really it hits, when the calamity really hits us hard, as a counselor, I've heard this from so many people in the community. Sheikh, where is God? Why he doesn't answer me? I really can't hack it anymore. Enough is enough. No one is there. For how long I'm saying, Ya Allah, I don't get any answer. The guy sat to collect the grains of like wheat. He said, let me see if I can collect them. And guess what? All of a sudden, he found pieces of gold. Gold coins spread on the ground. He again looked and says, what a beautiful God you are. What a kind and compassionate God you are. How stupid I was. Please forgive me. Please ignore what I said. گندمم را ریختی تا زر دهی. You dropped my wheat to give me gold. A farmer plants a seed to make a tree. A child who doesn't know the wisdom behind it says that, why daddy is just burying these seeds? Son, I'm burying them. Yes, I'm putting them underground so that they grow. They become a fruitful tree. Be patient. Sometimes deliberately Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts us through hardship, the wisdom behind, because He loves me to go to Him. Prophet Dawood alayhi salam kept communication with God, weeping, crying, asking for things that he wanted, for his spirituality, for his community, and one after the other it was granted. Another night he comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his supplication. God reveals him, Ya Dawood, we gave you all what you wanted. You had a list? We gave you all. Why are you here again? Dawood says, Ya Rab, you gave me all. But if I don't come, then I'm missing more important than that. And that is intimacy with you. Shaitan plays sometimes with our mind. We have to be very careful. Let me mention this also as well. Shaitan, and that's why we need a mentor sometimes. We need a good scholar in when shaitan is playing with our mind, to check it with a learned scholar to make sure that we are not trapped by the tricks of shaitan. A guy for quite a long time used to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to relieve him for some issues that he had in his life. And doesn't get anywhere. Ya Rab, didn't you ud'uni astajib lakum? Call me, I grant you. How many years I've been calling you? I don't apparently get any answer. One night shaitan comes to his dream and he says that, man, you're wasting your time. Any human for that many years you had asked, he would have some mercy on you, would have given you what you wanted. You're wasting your time. Stop it. He woke up and he said that, you know what, I think my dream is right. How many years I've been asking God, leave it. I'm not going to get up anymore. Night time asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, move on with my life. Maybe it's not meant to happen. Few nights later, this at the time of Prophet Musa alayhi salam, Imam Sadiq alayhi salam says, he passed by Prophet Musa. Prophet Musa says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is greeting you. I'll tell you that those who have broken their relation with God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ, I greet them first. I'm more eager. Any sinner here? God is more eager to see the sinners coming back to Him than us going to Him. I initiate سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ. Tell Him, come. He says, but Ya Musa, how many years I've been asking and nothing happens? Gof on Allah to labbaik maz was revealed to Moses. Tell him that you don't get it, my friend. Allah, Allah, Allahumma, that you are blessed to be able to communicate with me, says the Lord. Not every time they can hardly get the blessing to be awake the nights and months of Ramadan, communicate with me. It's a blessing that I don't grant you because I know you are such a mean person. If I give you tomorrow night, you won't turn up. You are only here because of your needs. But I like intimacy with you. I like you to be with me. Dua is not only a path to our needs. Dua is also our needs. We need to always feed our souls with supplications. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, sister, brother, and I've heard this from some of the newlywed young couples. They say that, Sheikh, before marriage, I used to pray to God day and night that I wanted to get married. Ya Rab, provide me a good spouse. And now that I got married, I'm even missing my morning prayer. Allahu Akbar. God says, see, I know how you are. I know what I've created. I know if I immediately grant you, you won't turn up. I don't want to miss you. So this is also another blessing of the dua. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Quickly, the third one, and inshallah we go to reading a few words of majlis. The third benefit of the dua is to keep the balance, especially if you have a status in the community. If you are someone that by the grace of God, not because we deserve it, by the grace of God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has maintained your reputation. That people, they respect you. Elderly people with all respect. Scholars with all respect. Anyone who has a status in the community somehow, in his family somehow. Because we get a lot of respect from the community, from other humans, by the grace of God, this develops, unfortunately, sometimes an attitude that I think that I deserve it. I tend to believe that, I'm really good. Look how people talk always good about me. This is very unhealthy. The benefit of supplication is that at night, yes, I am not allowed to belittle myself in front of humans. I need to maintain my respect as well and my dignity as well. But to keep the balance, night time, humiliate yourself before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have you ever thought, why is it that in the wise Islam, the Islam of the path of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, the Imam of Jama'ah has to be either on the equal level of the ground with Ma'mumin or lower? It's mustahab to make it a little bit lower and the Imam stands lower. You know why? Because standing ahead already gives a status. To keep that balance, Islam has recommended let the Imam stand a little bit lower, physically lower. Now, supplication at night, weeping and crying at night, this is what we learn from Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam. The Imam says, Allahumma la tarfa'ni fi an-nas darajatan illa hatta 'indi mithlaha. Ya Allah, do not elevate me, do not give me a status in the eyes of people, even a degree at all, unless you belittle me with myself, that I belittle myself with myself. To keep the balance, otherwise I will be suffering from the disease of arrogance, kibr, and things like that. Supplication has this benefit for us. The more I belittle myself before my Creator, before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more it helps me to keep that balance, which is very healthy for me. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. When we are doing supplication and dua at night, at best it is possible even namaz shab. If you are doing it at home, do it in a way that we don't disturb the family members. Somebody wants to sleep, has the right to sleep, it's a sleeping time. That's why we don't have azan for namaz shab. Huh? Tonight I want to take you to kharabe sham. Kharabe sham is an expression for a ruined and a shabby accommodation, so-called accommodation, they gave to who? To the family members of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, so-called captives of Karbala. Sayyid Zainab salamullah alayha, the granddaughter of the Prophet, the daughter of Fatima to Zahra is among them. Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam, even Imam Baqir, who was only 4 years old, imagine that they were all accommodated at the corner of out of the palace of Yazid Mal'un. There is also one four-year-old or so baby girl among them. Inshallah, I want to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in honor and respect of this shaheedah. She became a martyr, but not by sword, Allahu Akbar, but by tongue, which is more severe. Her name, some mention her name to be Ruqayyah, some Sukayne. She lost her mother right after her birth, Umm Ishaq. So she was so attached to her father, Imam Hussein alayhi salam. You can imagine a four-year-old girl who has lost her mother. Whole her life is her father, obviously, Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Now imagine on the day of Ashura, she has also lost her father, Imam Hussein alayhi salam. From Karbala to Kufa, from Kufa to Sham, sometimes she's seen the head of her father on the top of the spirit. Allahu Akbar. Look at this cruelty, barbaric attitude. When they were accommodated in Kharabe Sham, in that ruined place in Damascus, one night imagine the scene at the corner of that place, Sayyid Zainab Salamullah Alayha is quietly, she is doing her namaz shab. Seated. When later on she was asked, she said, because I have no strength to stand on my feet anymore. Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam is standing at the other corner offering namaz shab. There is silence in that place. Everybody is either quiet or asleep. All of the sudden they saw the baby of Hussein, Yatime Hussein, woke up crying, Ya Abata, Baba, Baba was here, my father was just here, where is my father? As much as Sayyid Zainab, remember this girl has no father, no mother, so Zainab was like a mother for her.
She goes to her knees and she says, "My dear, your father is not here, your father is here." She says, "No, auntie, my dad was just here, Allah. I was just talking to him." Everybody was crying, everybody woke up, and really it became a lamentation in the kharabe. Their voice was heard by Yazid Mal'un. He said, "What's happening?" They told him that the daughter of Hussein is asking for her father. And that Mal'un says, "Well, why can't you take the head to her?" Allahu Akbar. They put the holy head of Imam Hussein on a pallet, covered it with the lid, took it to Kharabe Sham and put it right in front of this 4-year-old girl. She removes the lid and looks at the head of Imam Abdullah al-Hussein. Ala la'natullah ala al-qawm al-zalimin. I didn't have the heart to continue it anymore. Ala la'natullah ala al-qawm al-zalimin. وَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيَّامٌ قَلَبٍ يَنْقَلِبُونَ أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ ويكشف السوء أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء بجاه محمد وآل محمد وبحرمة الفاتحة مع الصلوات.
اللهم صل على محمد.